Well, good afternoon, friends, family, acquaintances, and strangers. Welcome back to the teachings of Paul. We will be discussing 1 Corinthians chapter 4 today, but I have a question for you because I had a bit of a conundrum last night, and I'm wanting to know what you would do in this situation. Last night, I was watching a TV show, and I got the late night munchies, and I wanted to get my favorite snack, which for me, as healthy as it is, are Doritos dipped in sour cream. Now, in the Thomas household, there's two things that we have plenty of at all times: any dairy product and Doritos. However, I'm calling myself a liar now because we had no Doritos. And I went to the pantry to look for that bag and they weren't there. We had the sour cream, but no chips. And so my question to you is, would you have gone to the store around midnight to get those? And if you would, awesome. If not, what is your favorite midnight snack? That's really what I'm curious to know. Because mine, Doritos, sour cream to dip into. It's delicious, gets me through all my tough days, and obviously puts on my happy weight since getting married. But I wanted to know what your favorite midnight snack is. Maybe it's Oreos, maybe it's salsa and chips, something, I don't know. Just let me know. Shoot a comment in the comment section. I'd be amped up to hear that. But on to why I am on the video right now. You ever have a day where you just feel so close to God's presence, and it's almost like a tangible presence that you can just feel about you. Like something tough is going on, but you just feel that comfort, that inner peace from the Lord. That's what it's been like today. I just feel like God is just right there. Like if I were to stick out my hand as I'm walking, He'd be there holding my hand. And it's just an amazing thing. And so I was reading this chapter. I read it several times because chapter 4, it's a good chapter, don't get me wrong, it's wonderful. I was just trying to figure out something because Paul actually gets pretty personal in this chapter about what he's going through, and it's just uncharacteristic, I suppose, to hear that in the Bible because, you know, as a Christian, you want to profess good things, you want to profess life, and you don't want to look at your current circumstances and focus on them. You want to see the end prize. God's going to get you through, God's going to bless you through it. And as I was reading this, I was like, why is Paul sharing this? And then it was like that light went off, like the Holy Spirit just revealed to me what was going on. And so I want to get into that right now because I think it's a very important message for us to hear. I'm going to start by reading verse 9. And we're going to read about 6 verses here, so bear with me. Verse 9 in chapter 4. Instead, I sometimes think God has put us apostles on display, like prisoners of war at the end of a victor's parade, condemned to die. We have become a spectacle to the entire world, to people and angels alike. Our dedication to Christ makes us look like fools, but you claim to be so wise in Christ. We are weak, but you're so powerful. You are honored, but we are ridiculed. Even now we go hungry and thirsty, and we don't have enough clothes to keep warm. We are often beaten and have no home. We work warily with our own hands to earn our living. We bless those who curse us. We are patient with those who abuse us. We appeal gently when evil things are said about us. Yet we are treated like the world's garbage, like everybody's trash, right up to the present moment. You may have read that and be like, yeah, that's the story of my life. And for that, if that was you, I am so sorry. God bless you. And I just pray, Lord, that you bless them right now if that's how they feel. Because that's how no one should feel. And it's depressing to know Paul felt that way. But I want you to put yourself in Paul's shoes for a moment. As an apostle, he would be equivalent to like what we, I guess, today consider a modern day missionary. He goes into a place, or she goes into a place, where God's presence isn't known, where people don't know about God, about Jesus Christ, what his sacrifice was for us, the atonement for sin, our way to heaven only through Jesus. And they go there, they preach the gospel, they start a church, and then after the church matures, they move on to the next place. Well, I could imagine that would be a most difficult job. And for any modern day apostles out there and anyone who's a missionary, you know, you're sitting here thinking like, yeah, that's this is daily life, you know. We go without food, we're hungry, we have barely any clothes, people hate us, but yet all we're trying to do is do good for people here and to bless them. And he says, we toil with our hands, you know. It's not like they just went about just preaching. They actually were working, they were helping people. I'm sure they were, you know, they had a laundry list of people that needed chores done or projects worked on. They're like, hey, you know, come on over. And as Paul is with them, I'm sure he's preaching the gospel to them. But what is so critical to me about this is as I was reading it, I was thinking, why is Paul saying all this? And then it hit me when I reread the beginning. Paul's writing this because this is a church that is quarreling, that isn't seeing eye to eye about stuff, that they're having a lot of issues with one another. And he's basically saying, look it, I've gone through all this. I see this every day. I'm under so much chastisement for my faith on a daily basis. You know, use me as your example. Oh, sorry, the battery was dying, so I don't know if the video cut out there. But anyways, he said, use me as your example. As a matter of fact, he even says in verse 16, so I urge you to imitate me. And Paul is saying this to the Corinthian church because they're bickering and fighting and arguing and having all these issues. And Paul's like, guys, put yourself in my shoes for just 1 minute. This is what I deal with on a daily basis. So for me to hear that a church that I left in such good standing is dealing with these problems, you guys need a checkup from the neck up, as Pastor Rodney would say. You know, you guys need to stop and evaluate how good you have it. And in a way, I kind of relate it to America. Our churches here, they're you know, we have no excuse. We have we have freedom of religion. We have no type of oppression here. Matter of fact, there's so many tax laws that benefit us as churches. You know, we have no room to complain, yet we have such a hard time getting along with just the church right down the road for denominational differences, for an argument on theology, when it's like, guys, we love the same Christ. We love the same Father in heaven. And I just really, once I saw that Paul was just relating to the church to get them to sit back and be like, yeah, this is petty stuff. I mean, imagine being in Paul's shoes. It really kind of changed the way the chapter spoke to me. So that's what I wanted to get across here. It's what I wanted to share today. And at the end of this chapter too, I'll briefly say, he talks about being a spiritual father. And I think it's very important because so many people today, I hear them. I mean, they've spoken about it, and they're looking for a spiritual father. You know, oh, will you be my spiritual dad? Oh, hey, you have a great ministry. Hey, I just want you to be my spiritual dad. And it's like, hang on. Your spiritual father needs to be somebody that knows you, somebody you've built that relationship with and that you respect in authority as someone who hears from the Lord for you. And so I feel like instead of going around looking for a spiritual father, go straight to the source, go to God himself. And then as you're walking and chasing after the things of God, he's going to bring mature believers into your path. And one of them might sure be your spiritual father, and you can glean and learn from them. But you don't need to go like an orphan from church to church, leader to leader. Hey, spiritual dad. Hey, will you be my spiritual dad? It's like they're your spiritual dad for like 3 months, and then you're on to somebody else. Just go to God. Go to him with your issues. Go to him with your problems. He delights himself to be in communion with you, in communication with you, and to be sought after for your needs. He wants to meet your needs. So that's what I wanted to say today. I'm looking forward to tomorrow. I'm going over chapter 5 with you. Please, if you can take a second right now, just share this video, comment on there, and yes, please let me know what your favorite snack food is late at night. What is your guilty pleasure that you seek in out of the pantry? No answer is wrong. I mean, here I am dunking unhealthy chip into basically pure fat of sour cream. So, but I love it, and I can't help it, and I have to say it, she's not around. My wife loves it too. So anyways, God bless you. Thank you so much for joining. Share our video, and I hope this was a blessing to you. And just know, no matter how bad life is for you, just read what Paul had to go through on a daily basis. And I think it will help sober your day that it's not that bad. And you'll make it through. God will help you through today. All right, God bless you. Goodbye.